Good afternoon, everybody. We can start, I think. I'm very happy to be here with my new friends, because we met yesterday night with a very nice dinner. But we keep the funny story at the end. First, the things I have to say that unfortunately, Johann Rotsch is not able to come. He has a problem with the flight, which has been canceled this morning in Barcelona. So we miss one of our friends, but we will have more time to discuss together and to manage all the different arguments will be brought, raised up by all of them during this very interesting discussion. I will be super, super tight in my presentation because I'm here for them, not for me. Just to give you a brief introduction, as you know, that the title of the meeting of today is Environment, and I think it's very interesting how different authors from a very different path and formation have been brought here together. I think it's one of the quality of this biennial, which really brought different points of view on architecture. So we can enlarge the discussion on architecture, not consider architecture as the simple building, but architecture as a more complex and sophisticated arguments and process. So with me today, there will be, and I follow the order of presentations, Ugon Kowalski and Marcin Zelina, more or less, here. And then Michael Braungart from EPEA, here. And Matthias Schuler and Anja Tersfelder, sorry, from Transola. So I will not give any biographical background. Google is perfect from this point of view, and we don't need it. But I mean, I will move briefly from the setting that they design into this biennale. I think it's a good starting point. In the case of Ugon Kowalski and Marcin, the work is about, let's talk about garbage, let's talk about the way the garbage is at the center of a potential reflection on how to work on cities and communities. And they did a very powerful setting talking about illegal waste traffic and the three keywords, which is collecting, sorting, and processing, through an experience of research on Mumbai. And so their focus in this case, in the case of this research, is the way garbage is an element to be not only recycled, but is considered part of a community life. In the case of the work of Michael Braungart, the work is cradle to cradle, and it's an amazing, all the work he did is doing is kind of a way to revert the point of view. Michael is not an architect, he's a chemical engineer, if I don't mistake. And what I think is very interesting from his approach is the way he tried to change the point of view, which I think today is needed, is super important. And so the way he moves the discussion from guiltiness to desire, I think is fantastic, because to pass over the sense of guiltiness every time we work with the ecology and to work on the idea of architecture as a desire, as a way to do more and to do the better, which I think is also a very interesting way of creating a different mood on the approach on architecture and on environment. And I want to tell you that tomorrow at 11 o'clock in the Austrian Pavilion, there will be a public discussion celebrating our human footprint from the project Cradle to Cradle in the Austrian Pavilion. So I'm using also this situation to promote your beautiful experience. And the last intervention from Matthias Schuler and Anja Tersfelder is what you can see also here in the Arsenale. It is a powerful, emotioning work with light and darkness. The suggestion creates the mood, and everybody start work there is like working in a church. It is a fact. But their work, Transola, is working continuously with energy, with light, and is a way they work to re-educate architects to a completely different approach to the way they design architecture, you design the future environment. What I think is that the three of them are dealing with the process and strategies because they understand that today is no more a point of discussing on forms and styles, but it's a different, we are in a completely different historical moment where discussing on the basics, discussing on the strategies, discussing on the way we face problems, we try to solve them, is much more important. So I think that this is our starting point, and we could say we are here is with our logo could be good for you, good for the planet, which is a way to approach our meeting of today. So I immediately pass the first talk to Ugo Kowalski and Marcin
Stalina.
Perfecto. Good. Well, we will keep like 10, 15 minutes each, so we will have at the end time to have a discussion within us and most of all with you, if possible. And I think a discussion is much more interesting. Sometimes it can rise different arguments, different questions we are not expecting. So I introduce at the same time I do this. Okay. This is for you. Please.
Thank you. I will describe the our.
No, it's good.
I will describe our installation. So when I got the invitation email from Alejandro Arvena, it was very surprised for me. I'm quite young architect without any major project on my list. So I was very surprised. I immediately contacted with my friend Marcin Szczelina, who is architecture critic and also curator. And I asked him that it's maybe he will help me to design the Biennale installation. And I know already that he collaborated with Aaron Betsky during the Biennale in 2008. So I thought that he will get the bigger knowledge about everything. Alejandro Alavena suggests me to show my diploma project. This is the project Let's Talk About Garbage. You can see behind me. It's the project about the people who live in Daravia, and some part of these people are employing method is the recycling of garbage. So the government of Mumbai want to relocate them somewhere, but don't know where. So I decided this self-organized structure need to the landfill where they can settle in their own way. But it was the project about the people and how people can handle with the new situation. So we start to discuss how should look the installation of the Biennale. And we think that we shouldn't show the models or the buildings. We shouldn't find the problem. And our
yes, we think that Biennale it's a specific Biennale that we can discuss about the problem in architecture. So we really don't want to focus on the models or about the buildings to speak about the buildings. We think that we can use this opportunity to speak more about the problem which we architects should to deal with it. That's the reason we decided to take from Hugon project the subject of garbage and not focus on people but about the process. That's the reason we go to Asia, to the slums Daravi, when this project was made by Hugon, it's exactly taking part, and we make a research about the garbage.
So our main inspiration and idea was the words that we heard from the Mumbai planner who in conversation with us told us that in European you put everything to the plastic bag and you don't care what happened with it. Then, while in Asia, you open this bag and every piece inside is a good for us. So we try, on this image you can see that we have two sides. One side is the black, it's
It's the European side, European face of the garbage, and the second one is the Asia, kind of backstage of the garbage.
Also, we try to compare these two way of thinking. So our first step was we try to ask ourselves a very simple question, where does the garbage came from? And we start to make a very big research.
So when we start the research, we collect a lot of information, which we think it's very important, and we should show it during our installation. But the second way, we know that each people have only five minutes for each of the installation in Arsenal or in the National Pavilion. It's too much things going on to just explore our information during the Biennale. So we decided in the beginning to show the kind of history of the garbage and make a kind of timeline, because this is not the typical timeline. We decided to put some product which we buy originally from eBay. This is amazing what kind of thing we can buy in eBay and find it. And we find the original product for us was a milestone in garbages.
For example, we find the first paper tower from 1887, and the original package of the Pampers diaper, and original first paper napkins.
So if we know from where they came from and how the people in different ages deal with them, so we ask ourselves from where to where the garbage is traveling. So we collaborate with money institutions and thinkers, and we create that kind of traffic, illegal traffic map, waste map, and we try to find from where to where the garbage is traveling. And it is not any surprise that from the richest country, the garbage is traveling to Asia.
Because we need to know that sometimes it's finds time cheaper to send them to the Asia than to recycle in our countries.
And right now there is that kind of situation that from Asia is starting to produce their own garbages, and they don't need so much garbages from outside. So we're starting to sell the garbage to the Africa. So the question is, what will be next if the Africa start to produce own garbages? Where we will be sending our garbages? For example, each of us each day produce 1 kilogram of the garbages. So if in all world living a few billion of people, so the question is what's happening with all these garbages? So it's still, we have a lot of information which we want to show it. So we decided if somebody will be more interested, so we put that kind of postcard when you can find a lot of information about some statistic, which for us was very important, or what people thinking in different countries about the garbages. So the next step of our installation.
And the next step is the steel cage. That's we try to play with the visitors, and from the European side, we make a hole with the sign on the top. That you have finished your water, you can throw away the plastic bottle.
And you can throw away from this European side. So there is a hole that if you have a empty bottle, you can put it there and throw away. And we just only want to check if during the Al Biennale, how much waste, how much plastic bottle we will put there. And for example, this picture which you see right now, it's only from the opening, this blue one. So I think that this is important to show people, especially for us visual, that this is a huge problem. So that's the reason for us it was obvious which product we want to use to build our structure, our installation, and we use the most popular recycling material like paper, like plastic bags, like aluminium or textile. And we want to create that kind of theatrical, a little bit theatrical kind of scenario, that kind of wall of the trash to show people, to show us that they are everywhere and this is important part of our life.
So also this sketch is the first step of our process. It's when the product changed to the garbage. And then we have next project is collecting, sorting and transforming. And each of the parts, we try to show also quite interesting information from Asia. For example, the Kamikatsu city, it's the city in Japan, where people segregate 100% of the garbage.
Yes, and for example, this is a very funny story because when we start to check Kamikatsu city, then we discover a few interview with the people who live in there, and they are not happy to have 34 boxes in each kitchen, and then must deal with 100 garbages each day. This is, it can be one of the example how we can more stop it. And also in each of the step, we try to put the video which we made during our trip to Asia, and they came from the landfill, the Onar, the bigger one landfill in Mumbai, and from the Dharavi slums.
And also we try to show that it's a different way to segregate and transform garbage, because mostly in Europe we burn garbage and we can choose another way. On the end of installation we have two digressions. One digression is the space that you go upstairs. There is my diploma project, let's talk about garbage. And the second digression is the wave steel cube on the end. It is the exactly slums unit that you can go enter in and you can feel how big it is. And in this space we show the project
Lighter of Light.
Lighter of Light, designed by MIT, which is a very small project, but the impact is amazing. This project changed the behaviors of people who lived in slums and worked there, because they found how to eliminate interior without energy, and it's easy because you need only plastic bottle, water, and few drops of bleach.
And we put this installation on a box, which the similar box with one single family in Asia live in that space. And third and the last small digression on our installation is about the paper. We produce a lot of kind of flyers, postcards, and we discovered that whenever we are coming to Venice for the opening, a lot of people were collecting a lot of catalogs and a lot of different things. So each of us have many materials. So the last postcards in our installation is, do you really need so much waste, especially that only 10% from each printing houses are from recycling paper. So we generate the new waste and we are taking it to our homes. So this is the question, if we really need so much catalog and different stuff.
Of course, this is Architecture Biennale, so we try to respond for the question how the architecture can...
Yes, this is, I think that for us the most important question, like when we speak about garbage, so during the Architecture Biennale, the question about how architecture can participate in process of recycling and how architecture can reduce amount of waste, I think that this is a very important question. So that's the reason we try to answer from this European side. And we make the research about the commercial companies who produce, for example, bricks
carpet.
Yes, and floor typical panels. Materials which our house has built. And we choose this the most popular that each visitor can know few of them. And we send them some questions.
And I think that's in these questions are two very important. One is What's your company statement about sustainability? And second is, how many recycled material is your product? So we can compare these two answers and see how is real life looks like.
So this is very sad because when we send this question, we also write that the answer will be put at our installation. And of course, most of the companies didn't agree to be part of it, or when they realized that we want to make it more public, so they decided not to collaborate with us. And some of them sent the answers, and we decided to put it on the wall without any editing. And you can see how, for example, PR person from the company trying to answer that the company is really deal about circular economy or sustainability. But in the question about how much recycling material it's used into the production, the new product, it's like, for example, 10%. And I think that this is the answer for our installation and good point that you can speak about how this is important problem, and but if we not start to deal with it, to as an architect have some responsibility to collaborate with that company, so we can do anything. We can just only talking about it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
There's a, in one of the, there are few videos that are really very strong and very interesting. There's a, which probably you did in Mumbai. There's, you can see those the people just searching in the mud on these strange liquid fragments of metal or plastic and separating them one by hand is a kind of new craftsmanship of desperation, and it's so touching and it's so strong because you can imagine the kind of air they are breathing that moment and the kind of pollution they are individually getting every day trying to do something to survive. So it's a kind of paradox, and that was was thinking, listening to you about this kind of, I don't know if it's a legend or not, you know, this, there are stories that sometimes apparently there's these huge floating islands of garbage floating in the middle of Pacific Ocean, which is apparently is bigger than a real island, which is the result of flows of garbage in the sea that are connecting each other and they're creating this kind of artificial floating islands. I don't know if it's existing or not, but
we're trying to find the pictures, but it's very hard to find anything about it.
But I think that even though if it's not real, I think it's a kind of a symbolization, visualization of our sensation, of our sense of responsibility in relation to what we produce. No, because talking about garbage, it's kind of this garbage obsession, talking about the Japanese, is a kind of never-ending solution, no? Because how can we recycle continuously even though we need the object, we need things to, no? So the life of the object and the way the object are packed and produced create a kind of natural or artificial garbage, which is a kind of never-ending story. So I still don't understand where all this situation will arrive. If we be a planet covered with garbage, so like in some movies, or so it's still something which I think is a real ongoing problem. It's something that is interesting to face.
We need to remember that we have space.
Eh?
We have space.
We have this, to send the garbage
abroad. Yes. Still, there is some space.
Well, yeah. Somebody is considering that. You know, it's that they are starting to do it.
Okay.
So okay. So thank you very much. And. Let's move from, let's say, from garbage to a larger, let's say, vision. And I will ask to Michael Braungart to talk now. This is your. Okay. So, please.
Yes. So.
This is.
Thank you. Yes. So good afternoon. For today, I decided I'm teaching at the business school in Rotterdam and in Delft for the architect, some areas in Twente for the materials. And I decided for this afternoon to switch into a new role, which is called Brown Guard Insulting, basically, instead of consulting, because it's really amazing. You walk by and people drink this Aperol spritz. Yeah. These idiots, yeah, but they all do this. How shall we talk about environment when they drink a chemical, this orange, which I tried to get out of textiles for 20 years, yeah, and they drink it, yeah. So what do you do with these people? It's just, there is obviously not any way of self-esteem, because people drink artificial color, which is heavily sensitizing, which degrades into carcinogens, quite strong carcinogens, which is destroying your immune system, and you drink Aperol spritz and you think you're the greatest architect in the world. How funny. So I want to talk to you about...
That's why probably we are in Venice. I mean, Venice is the perfect way to have biennial, so everybody drinks and they feel a star after the spritz.
Yeah, sure, no, the city is definitely connected to death, and so it's great, definitely, so it's okay. So let's talk about things which are massive problems. And we are losing about 4 to 5 years of our lifespan by inhaling fine dust. And that's amazing, because even by alcohol, even with Aperol spritz, you only lose about 2 years as an average. And it already includes all the alcohol dependent. And when you drink your Aperol spritz, you already can, at least till the third glass, you can decide whether you want to drink or not. But with inhaling fine dust, you cannot decide about it. So 15 times more people die of fine dust than of traffic accidents. And this is interesting, because it's an architectural challenge. It's an opportunity. So people said, oh, let's go back to natural materials. And I'm analyzing, people look at the outside air, but I'm analyzing inside air, indoor air. And the indoor air pollution in a building is about 3 times worse than outside urban air. Yeah. Now people are sealing the building, Minergie, yeah, they try to reduce the energy consumption. So they basically make buildings into gas chambers, because they are sealing buildings, yeah, and instead of looking what is healthy air, they make the wrong things perfect, and then they are perfectly wrong. Yeah. So all the peaks which you see on these slides are all chemicals off-gassing. But I want to tell you a different message with that. People now go back when they hear about chemicals, they said, oh, let's use natural materials. Here is a carpet, 100% wool. But this carpet has far more peaks than a polyamide carpet, a nylon carpet, because the nylon is designed for the carpet, but the sheep is not designed for the wool, for the carpet. Yeah? So the sheep is not designed for that purpose. And when you want to make a sheep red wine resistant, yeah, it takes a lot of chemicals. So we have far more dangerous chemicals off-gassing than we have from a nylon carpet. And as well, you're never in touch with the wool, you're only in touch with Teflon. Yeah? It's a Teflon carpet, Scotch guard, and there's some wool inside. So we are romanticizing nature. We think, oh, Mother Nature, but it's not a natural material at all. The worst of all are flame retardants. Yeah? I'm analyzing human milk now, mother's milk, for 28 years, and there's not one sample which you could sell as drinking milk, not one. Yeah. And the legal limits for drinking milk are exceeded for some parameters for several hundred times, not just a little bit. So the fastest growing peaks we find in human milk are flame retardants from styrofoam. So if you just do me one favor today, stop using styrofoam for insulation, because it's not designed for that purpose. It doesn't make sense. And the flame retardants are really terrible. They behave like female hormones, and they are strong carcinogens. And even this is from a lead platinum building. Yeah, you have 5 grams of. So isn't it amazing? These architects are certifying buildings. Yeah, silver, gold, and platinum. Yeah, platinum is one of the 10 most toxic heavy metals I know. Yeah, so the highest level of certification is a toxic heavy metal. Yeah. Why don't we talk at cyanide level? Yeah, whatever. Then people understand what I'm talking about. So I'm analyzing stuff which people recycle into buildings. And here, for example, you have a Ford or a Skoda or Fiat, and this car contains about 40 different steel alloys. And what do they make out of it? Building steel. And the architects do it. Yeah? There's no self-esteem. Yeah, they just make, they lose all these rare elements, copper, nickel, chromium, manganese, molybdenum, yeah? All stuff gets diluted in building steel. and they call it recycling. How funny, because, but it's not funny at the point which you can see here. When the, because of more efficient use of copper, the steel it gets, we have higher and higher concentration of copper in building steel. And when the steel copper concentration is higher than 0.5%, the steel breaks like an osteoporosis bone. I was in Turkey in 99, and I found that at least in 80% of the samples which we tested, we had copper concentration higher than 2%. So people died of an earthquake at a much lower intensity than it would normally kill people. There were 20,000 people killed by poor steel quality as one of the key factors. And we just analyzing steel from the last earthquakes here in Italy, and it shows the same tendency. Yeah. So the steel breaks so much easier when you have copper in it. So if you do me just one favor today, make steel, building steel just out of iron, a little carbon, nickel is not a problem at all, but all the other elements should be out of it. So we are downcycling used vehicles, and we call it recycling when we lose all these rare elements. Just one copper mill in Hamburg, Germany, makes 4 times more waste by copper production than the whole municipal waste stream of Europe, just with one copper mill. 2/3 of all the copper is already in mined. So it doesn't help us to be a little less bad. People talk to you, please reduce your carbon footprint, reduce your energy bill, reduce your water consumption, protect the environment. But you're not protecting when you destroy a little less. When I tell you, please beat your wife only 5 times instead of 10 times, do you really protect your wife? No, you're only minimizing damage. Yeah. In that logic, East Germany has been protecting the environment so much better than West Germany just by inefficiency. They couldn't destroy all the wetlands, so don't make the wrong things perfect. So we need to reinvent all the stuff. Everything what gets consumed, like shoe soles, like brake pads, need to be designed for biosphere. Food, detergents, Aperol spritz needs to be designed for the biosphere. Yeah. Otherwise, you're just making toxic waste. And sure, then you can take care of waste, but if you take care of waste without a different design, you have just a perverse anal fixation, because it doesn't really help you. You're just stabilizing the wrong things. You need to really design the things differently. So people now put these solar panels on their roofs. How stupid. Why can't you put a solar panel on your roof and buying it? A European solar panel keeps its effectiveness for 20 years with 93%. The Chinese solar panel loses its efficiency already after 5 years for half of it. Now the Chinese solar panel is 1/3 cheaper. So they buy the solar panel, but over a use period of 20 years, the European solar panel is much cheaper. So why do you buy a solar panel when you just want to harvest photons? Why do you buy a TV set when you just want to watch TV? Why do you buy a washing machine when you just want to have clean clothes? So everything is a service or a consumption product, a service for the technosphere. This is my installation with my colleagues from IPEA. I think there is one top scientist here from the Institute, Suki Kleryang. Do you know where she is? Okay, here, you can ask her. And she is key for helping to find the right chemicals. This is a report from the Brandt, and it shows how we can make buildings beneficial, buildings like trees. So why don't you ask your architects to have buildings where indoor air quality is better than outside air? Right now, 40% of our houses in Europe have mold, schimmel in Dutch, because they are not made actually for humans. And now you're sealing these houses, you make the wrong things perfect. So it's about buildings as material banks. You can use, if you make the solar collector a service, then you don't need to own it. We now have windows on the market from a German producer where we sell just 25 years of looking through insurance. So we don't need to reduce, avoid, minimize. We can make this a building like a tree, a building which cleans the air. A building which absorbs fine dust. Why don't you make facades which actively absorb fine dust? We make carpets which absorb fine dust, and they're amazingly profitable, because why should I use my 100 square meters of lung to clean the air when a carpet can do so? We now can use 40 years of blame and shame as an innovation engine. But can we do this really for this Aperol Spritz generation? I have some doubts. I would like to invite you for the matinee tomorrow at the Austrian Pavilion. Yeah, and we can discuss with Christoph Ingenhofen, with Sarah Wiener. I think Sarah is here as well. Sarah is a very famous chef because it's no longer about efficiency. Yeah, you always want to be eco-efficient. You always want to minimize damage. Think about an efficient dinner tonight. It would be a tablet with some Italian flavor and a glass of water. Yeah, that's efficiency. Yeah. Think about a lipstick, for example. A woman eats about 6.3 kilograms of lipstick during her lifetime.
Really? How
yeah.
much?
Yeah, 6.3 kilograms. But it's not really accurate because we don't know how much gets kissed away. But yeah. So, but a lipstick, even in the dark here, I can tell you, completely inefficient but very effective. Yeah. Think about architecture, which is not efficient but effective. So in each building, we put 5 key elements which we work. And it's nice not to be an architect because then we can work for all the architects. We can support them. So basically, I'm with my colleagues, the material boy of architecture, like Madonna would say. So I can back you up with the right materials together with my great colleagues. And we can do this. And sure, we need designers. So there's Friederike von Wedel, for example, who made the whole installation so beautiful that you can see it, that people, so there is 6 tons of clay which is transformed into footprints. So you can go there. It's a main building. It's a Biennale Giardini. And you can make your own footprint because we celebrate footprint instead of minimizing damage. So why don't we use it for a positive agenda instead of being less bad? A city like Rome wants to be climate neutral. How funny. Did you ever see a climate neutral tree? So with all our brain, we want to be more stupid than a tree. Think about you come home and you said, I'm child neutral today. Yeah? What an idiot. But people say, hooray, climate neutral. Yeah. Why don't you want to be climate positive? Why don't you make an architecture causes 2/3 of all the waste is architecture. It's nice to look at packaging, but look at architecture first. And architecture is the biggest source for pollution and damage. And if you would say, look, in 2020, all our buildings are designed to be good, which to support life, to have clean air. You know, if half of all the chemicals which I find in human milk and mother's milk are from buildings, and still I can tell you it's good to breastfeed your baby, because the mother can detoxify herself. Yeah. With one baby, you lose 1/3 of your pollutants, so it's really good, isn't it? Yeah. There's nothing similar for men. Yeah. For men, don't they have a similar detoxification than breastfeeding? Yeah. So why don't we make an architecture which is designed for human milk? If you would say, from today, my architecture is designed for healthy breast milk, then I can provide you with the right materials. If you just want to be 10% less evil, then you can eat your pizza. Yeah, your pizza uses the paper chemicals from paper recycling. Yeah, and the paper chemicals go in as fillers into cardboards. So with one cardboard pizza, you eat 1/3 of a business card weight. Yeah, from the printing chemicals. So if you want to do circular economy, it's so easy. The simple thing is eat oysters. Yeah. We talked about marine pollution. Each oyster has at least 1,500 pieces of plastic in it. If you want to do circular economy, get the plastic out of the ocean, eat oysters. It's so simple to save the planet. Thank you very much.
As you can imagine, the experience of having a dinner with Michael can be very dangerous because it's good that we did not offer you a pizza yesterday night. But we will come back to the relationship with architects, the designer, which I think will be another round of discussion later on. Thank you very much. Now, Matthias Schuller and Anja Teersperdel by Transola, please. It's me. So that's me. I'm sorry. Multitasking is always part of being an architect, but you know. It's okay. Then. Here.
Okay, I'm one of the architects who has to take the channel to build some buildings for healthy breastfeeding. But for today, I will tell you a little bit about our installation here. When I first heard the title of this year's Biennale, Reporting from the Front, two thoughts popped up in my mind. First thing is the significance and uniqueness of every little piece of land, and second, the presence of natural forces. Since I'm dealing with architecture, it really concerns me that architecture has to happen on a piece of land. There's no empty piece of land. That is, no matter what and where you are building anything, you always have to displace something or somebody. There are cultures somewhere else, here for example in Thailand, who I find it quite inspiring how they are treating the memories of the former inhabitants of a piece of land. They make a site and build something on it. The so-called spirit houses, they are used to give the former inhabitants a place to live on. Last week in the news, there was the latest Living Planet report of the WWF published that we are consuming a lot more, 1.5 times more of the world's resources than our planet could balance in any case. The resource, as I said, that really concerns me is the resource of land, which is defined and can, there's no way to extend it. So I think we all know, we have seen landscapes changing and always almost disappearing. If we move through landscape for a longer time, you just see what happens. We all know that species extinct just for lack of space, and also the human populated areas, so in Bangladesh, for example, in one of the densest populated countries of the world, already a country for producing food is just lacking, is missing. So I think it's high time that we all understand something about the resource of land, and as architects, furthermore, that I think it's important that we treat every piece of land as unique. It's dealing with the local identity will strengthen every architecture, and if we are lucky, architecture has a chance to ingrain within the site and become unique as well. That's my first point. And my second point was the presence of natural forces, enormous forces. And for the installation, we right from the start, we intend to use one of these very powerful natural phenomena as eye catcher or as light motif. I just like the idea that it's somehow a collective experience that touches everyone of us emotionally. If we just are confronted with this phenomena, discovering a rainbow or experiencing the sunset, watching the sea, finding a falling star or something like that. We were planning to choose one of these phenomena, and then we wanted to create an exhibit out of it, so we wanted to bring it from outside to the inside. Here to the Arsenale in this case, and recreating this natural phenomena as lifelike as possible. Finally, we choose visible sun rays, so-called crepuscular rays. We all know from children's drawings or from walks in the forests or from special weather conditions where the sun is partly blocked by clouds. We choose this phenomena because this exhibit could directly connect to a project Transolar worked on, where local identity became an impulse for architecture.
Yes, in this project, the picture is on is a picture of a 1:30 model of the Louvre Abu Dhabi by Jean Nouvel. There, Jean Nouvel, from the beginning, had the idea of a phenomena which he calls the reign of light, that under this huge dome, if you may have seen this design of a 180-meter diameter dome around 30-meter high in the air, he wanted to see the beams of light coming into the space. And in our discussion, as we as consulting engineers, he said, Matthias, this is well something I want to see. And I said, Jean, this will be a hard ride, because we will, in a certain way, have to limit your freedom in architecture to make this phenomena visible. First, we have to study it really from its physical basics, and then we will advise you in your architecture, which will limit your architecture. But if this is your target, we will do it. And it was a 2-year partially discussion, partially fight to make this finally happen. And you just now, if you Google, you can find the rain of light, the first videos from the real building being visible. Now, as Anya mentioned, the effect behind this effect is called the so-called Tyndall effect. Mr. Tyndall, a Swedish researcher, physicist, kind of find it out that these rays are happening because the sun is hitting little particles in the air and scattering the light. So, but it's clear the intensity of this light beams is quite limited. So you have to be aware that you are working with a quite sensitive light source if you want to make this happen. What is interesting, when we studied it, there is another effect you have to have in mind, that this dome flying in a height of 30 meters, our sun, which is 150 million kilometers from our planet, still has a diameter of 0.7 million kilometers. So it's a range of 1 to 200 between the diameter of the sun and the distance, which means we all talk about that the rays of sun are parallel. They are, but there's a ray from the left corner of the sun and the ray from the right corner of the sun. And they make that the shadow of a square in a height of 30 meter will slowly disappear at the edges. It's not a sharp edge, it's kind, and this is called the divergence of the sun. And the divergence of the sun is 0.3 degree. So it's not a parallel line, it's a little cone with an angle of 0.3 degree. So having this in mind, you have to find out that if a hole in the stone which is smaller than 1 meter will totally disappear, will not come down as a real point, and will only create background light. So one of the first design advices was all your holes should be bigger than 1.5 meter to make sure you really see the light point at the end on the floor. What is interesting, if you try now to make it, you find out you can scale light. So you can build a model in 1:33 and try to reproduce the effect. It will be, if you size the hole in 1:30, you will have the same effect than reality. Mentioning that this light effect is happening by dust, you can scale the light, but you can't scale the dust. So it took us 3 months to say, okay, how we prove in a 1:30 model of the whole dome, we could build, and we build it a 1-to-1 example of a 12 by 12 meter element of the roof. We did a test in a huge kind of cylinder, and it came out that it works, this one element would work. Now then we put it in the 1:30 model, and even Monsieur Nouvel insisted that the model was made out of shiny aluminium. I told him from the beginning, Jean, it will not work. He put his head in the 1:30 model and it didn't show up. There was no rain of light. He was complaining. I said, Jean, I told you it can't be shiny. It has to have a certain size of the opening. The color has to be. So all this kind of connections. So that was the lesson. And then we learned we have to find a method to scale the dust from the reality to the model. So what we did We built a 1:30 model of the 1:1 model and calibrated the amount of haze, the amount of artificial fog we have to put in to reproduce the visual effect of the 1:1 model. And then we walked into the 1:30 model with exactly this amount of haze. And we could reproduce, and we could, in a certain way, give the advice and prove that the concept was working. So that's the background of this kind of rains of light. And when we started to work here on the Biennale, looks now I think it's maybe Luca, you can do the next slide. Yeah, there happened something in it. Okay, there would be the next one would be a slide.
Okay.
This is now the background of the crepuscular rays we see from the sun. In reality, and we can't believe it, and even me as a mechanical engineer close to physics, I couldn't, in the first minute, if you see it from the sun, you don't believe that they are really parallel. But it's only a kind of a perspective kind of effect that you see them coming from one point. In reality, and this is now a section to the endless, you see each cloud is creating this effect. If you would, this is a picture from the ISS, from Space Lab, putting down on Earth, and you can see more or less the shadows of the clouds hitting the ocean. And this is the crepuscular rays with, at the end, we see as lines diverging. But in reality, they're ending, or visually for us, they're ending in one sun, in one fearless point, but in reality, they are all parallel. So, yeah, it's there.
No, it's not there. It's here, but it's not there.
Okay. Is it me? Did I?
Wait, there's a problem. Chum.
Wish you were here.
Yeah, but we can see, it's nice, we can see, but I don't
know. That's good.
It's coming back, probably it's coming back. Yeah. Maybe. Okay, it's coming back. Maybe I push the. So, the computer is running out of battery. Okay, so when we started to work on it with Anya, she was our architectural advisor because, you know, certainly we are engineers, but to create a beautiful installation on the Biennale, you shouldn't work as an engineer on your own. You need a collaborator, you need an architect. So Anya was our collaborating architect, and we started to build a 1:20 model of the space, in order to see how we develop this, reproducing the crepuscular rays in the space. And you see, you can do it very simple. These are by silver, little silver lines, building in the space to say, okay, this is how it would look like. In the space, still being aware that it's hard to reproduce as well the perspective of your eye looking in such a model. It's not exactly reproducing what you would see in reality. Then we use the same model and just putting a black carpet on top of it, drilling some holes in it, and using the real sun as a light source. So this is a shot of a 1:20 model where, together with Anya, we composed the beams of light in this space, how they would in a sort of activate, maximate, how they would communicate with the columns, how we have to be aware that there's a next space. We need this curtain out of strips, you know, certainly to make sure we are not having this big contrast. And then finally, we moved, another 5 minutes, we moved into the Arsenale. And it was the first day, I can tell you, it was like the 7th of February this year. And it was outside already around 12 to 14 degrees. We walked into the Arsenale, it was freezing cold, 7 degrees. Spending a day in 7 degrees, like living in a fridge for a day. So this was one of our first tests in the space to see, and it was as well, you walk in the space, and even we did an installation 2010, we did a cloud, but still I lost the memory. Coming back now, being in this space 7.5 meter high, 28 meter long, 20 meter wide, this is amazing. You are really impressed that, oh shit, this is something you have to fill up with an installation. So this was quite, and then feeling that this space is so cold, so humid, so that was quite impressive. And now this is the last picture. So finally, it took us another 3 months in a circuit to finally develop the final installation in a very close collaboration. We had several trips to Venice, the final installation as well, kind of reflecting on local identity, which was our theme aside of this visual effect, local identity of a location, which is defined by climate, which is defined by the soil, by the light, but as well by the material on a certain location. And typically, if we look back in history, material then defined craftsmanship. So for example, we installed this 5 wooden ladders. And there, these ladders are ladders normally used in our apple trees if you pick the apples. But they are built like to fit in that you can reach up to the highest apples without falling down. So kind of thinking on handcraft, which is as well a local identity, or using these cotton strips for our exit curtain, which is from an old weaving company, which are weaving this cotton weaves since 100 years. And they are still there, and you still can buy them. So I think this is something we have, as architects, should see as a richness, that each location, aside of its climate, its resources, it has culture, it has craftsmanship, which are local identity we have to have in mind if we are doing a design for a certain location. And I think, Anya, you should close with this final impression on this picture. I think it was most...
No, it's about, I think it's about this collective experience. I said now people are coming and a lot of them are just playing with the light. That's what we expected, and I'm very happy that it happened.
Well, I think that to survive to 5 degrees in February allowed us to walk in the light in mid of May when it was so warm, was perfect. And so the effect was fantastic, and it's still fantastic, and it's changing because the temperature inside is changing. So I think
people.
That along the months, the quality of light and dust is also changing. The presence of people is changing a lot, the environment around. I think that one of the very interesting common elements of the three talk we listen is the way all of them look at the basic elements, something that say underground, the DNA of these elements as material for a different kind of construction. I mean, from the chemical point of view, from let's say you can consider natural elements as construction elements, or from the garbage as a kind of hidden economy in a lot of communities, which can be transformed into something positive, like in the litter of light, for example. All those three talks explain the necessity to change the point of view, to make a shift. Only shifting, you can look to the same things from a different light, and you can try to consider a different kind of methodology and approach, which for me today is the element, is the argument, because we will face more and more emerging problems, like in grabbing of lands and wasting of lands, which is one of the arguments. The 21st century is the century where we try to save something, we try to destroy that along the old 20th century. So this century is a kind of century of recovering on one side, but on the other, we cannot stop. We cannot say, okay, we don't do anything. No, it's impossible. Life is going on. And so this is one of the points. No? So I would like to know from both of you, how do you relate with the designer? I mean, both of you are used to work with the designer, and one of the elements, which I think is very interesting, that every time you talk about that, you talk about the word is limit. No? It says, like, every time you change the point of view, you are limiting something, which is not. You're just only changing the perspective, no? But the traditional designer considers them as a limit, not as a limit to their vision.
Freedom.
So how is it working with them, and how can you give us some stories? I'm not talking about theory. Some story which explains how the work with the designer can change an approach with important result for the next decades, because the point is, as you said before, to create in 10 years building which will be allowed to clean up the air for us, no? So, which is completely, we move from passive to active, which is fantastic, I think. But so how to educate or how to relate with designer to reach a good design solution, because at the end we are talking about real buildings, space, with the quality of life, budget, I mean, all the kind of things that we are used to. So I would like to know from you both some experiences from them, and then I will end up with my left side.
So I would say my strategy since 25 years working in Transla is like, you should sell it to the architects not as a limitation, but as an additional kind of creative support, that this can help you. And there's a great story with Günter Behnisch, which is the father of the Behnisch architects in Stuttgart, when he did a building in northern Germany, and we came in and he asked us, so what would you do in a certain way? He had a huge entrance hall and he wanted to have it fully glazed. And we said, oh, it's facing south, it will be pretty warm. What would you do with it? The best would be to put a 30-meter chimney on the building. And I thought he would kick us out of the office. And he took it and he said, the building was in the floor plan like a star. He said, this is exactly creating the middle, the heavy point for my building. So he grabbed it and really finally installed this 30-meter high black chimney in the middle of the building. So I think we engineers, we should not be shy. There should be a base with the architects that we are thinking loud. We are proposing all the possibilities, and they, if they are creative enough, they will grab the chances they see in one or the other proposal. And it's clear they will not take all. But my strategy is as well, it will take time. It as well takes time to educate them. And as I, last night we discussed on it, with Helmut Jahn, it took me 10 years to do the best building. It took, the first building, he would kick me out the door. After 10 years, he kind of, it reached his mind. It's reached his basic understanding. I think that's the way how the collaboration should work. And architecture designers should be open enough to accept advice in such a team.
What about you working with the with the? I mean,
Sorry. To be honest, as you said, it takes time. In the last time, if you're looking at in the news, and last time, I am just wondering whether we have enough time, and I think it would be good to start right now. If you think about the enormous growth of population and so on,
time and urgency.
Kind of emergency.
That's the point.
Sometimes I really feel that.
This is one of the points. I agree with you, because there's a kind of demographic pressure.
Yeah.
Which is, because from our point of view in this continent, we don't see how in other situations this pressure is creating situations which are continuously wasting land and energies and materials.
And as I just said this morning, I'm really wondering why developments in architecture are so related if you compare it to developments in other branches, like in producing cars, they know the next step. We don't know if this is the solution for eternity, but we know that the e-cars are the next step. So so much time, which is, I cannot really understand why, but in architecture, I think not even the problem is really defined. It's not defined. I cannot see, if you look in literature, what it's new, it's all about design and form and new media influences or new tools on the computer and so on. But it's not we are not yet, in my opinion, at a point that we know what's necessary. What I mean, some of your ideas, are quite close.
I was connecting to you. Because, I mean, the both of you are talking about this argument, no? Because it's so, which is a.
Look, there are not many people like you which are invited twice in such a short time. Yeah. Because of your famous work, and since I saw your work, I understand the architects much better, because they like your sculptures, they like your light sculptures, and the light sculptures only work with fine dust. So that's why the architects don't do anything about fine dust, because they like these sculptures. Isn't
but in this, in the Biennale case, it works with humidity. You can replace fine dust by water droplets. So in the Arsenale, you can go there. It's just water.
Yeah. So yes, that was just my idea, that you could replace the dust by water vapor, it would work as well. It's the same if you would replace olive oil in pan frying, yeah? Because we now have three famous chefs in Europe which die of lung cancer because they always use the olive oil in frying, yeah? Can you imagine? And so they actually inhale all these aerosols because the olive oil is not designed for that purpose. Yeah. And it's, but you could make, maybe with olive oil aerosols, you could make the same type of sculptures with that as well. What I want to say is that this nicely fits together. Look, Albert Einstein, or was it Michael Braungart, I don't know, said that you can either calculate light into energy and energy into material, or material into energy, and energy is light with that, he said the Earth is nothing else than frozen light. Yeah? This gives light a completely different perspective, and when you see light, material, and waste, then you see where we are with our environment and with the architecture, because we take such a poetic way, an opportunity of this planet to make it into a big dump site. Yeah? And this is mostly because our design is not like that. And I would love if we could discuss positive goals. If you would say, look, why don't we make things different? Because we are designers, we are not just beautifiers. But instead of that, people use, I saw this here, people use these plastic PVC bags. from trucks, yeah, to make bags out of it, Freitag or whatever.
Freitag.
This, every normal person doing child abuse is more honest than this type of thing, because it puts all these endocrine disrupting chemicals directly in a children's room and destroys the life of the child for the whole life by that. And I can give you endless stuff. So what I want to tell to my colleagues is, don't make recycling of wrong things, because otherwise you make the things perfectly wrong. Yeah. And then you're just prolonging a wasteful thing. When you make plastic into park benches, for example, yeah, what does it really help? Okay, there are a lot of homeless people who might need park benches, but this, what else, what after is after the park bench with that? So it doesn't really help. So we need to take designers and architects together, because the first signal of human intention is design. Yeah? So let's think about what makes us human. It's design. So why don't we take it seriously? Because right now, this is all toxic waste. But maybe it's nice dust sculptures with that, maybe that.
Well, I think it's very interesting, as you said, I found it very interesting when you talk about the material banks. Because probably we will move soon, hopefully, not only from material banks, but also to the banks or the archive of the recycled materials. Because, I mean, as we know, as you show very well in this the dramatic situation of the earthquake in Turkey, the point is not only to discuss about the raw material, the basic material, but to see that how, if the recycle is doing badly because you don't know the story of the material itself, then you create even bigger monsters. So probably today, one of the elements would be to work on the data bank also of the material used in the last 50 years in the construction phase to consider the recycling or not.
I mean, no, this might be that you generate a lot of work and a lot of jobs, etc. But no, it needs design goals, clear goals to say, look, steel for buildings is just made of of iron, carbon, and a little nickel. That's it. Why should you have a database for that? Otherwise, you don't accept it as a building steel. Yeah, there are 300 additives being used in concrete, and you can make a database about it, but 200 of them are as nasty as Aperol spritz, basically. So,
if it's better to drink Aperol spritz instead of concrete.
On Aperol spritz, but they have similar toxic effects in that. And 200 of them, if you say, look, we want to have concrete which is designed that you can leave it as an artificial rock in the environment, then you can exclude 200 by them. It's more about your ambition. So don't make databases. When you say, I want that my building is designed for human milk, for mother's milk, then you don't need to make a big database, because otherwise you're just doing databases permanently. Okay. And no, you said it's designed and you have to prove it, that it's, that the materials which I get, so it's your database problem, yeah, which I get, are designed for that. If you cannot prove it, I don't buy it. Okay. But just one thing to be accurate, first of all, I really can recommend to have children, because the mother can detoxify herself, as said, you lose one third of your pollutants, but as well, it's still better than any Nestle milk powder, but only for maximum 9 months, because then it's chemical harassment, because the liver doesn't function first, so it builds up with the baby, so most of the pollutants just flush through, they don't get metabolized. So no Nestle milk powder. Yeah, up to 9 months, it's maximum for breastfeeding. No esoteric 2 years breastfeeding, but still, we don't have a similar solution for detoxifying men. Yeah, so.
Our friend talked about the dark side of pollution, or the dark side of garbage, okay. And which is which I think it's important to consider today, because it's a further step. Let's say, mm-hmm. I think it's important, but. What is interesting about your work is a kind of this wall separating, let's say, the garbage world, like local communities in so-called the underdeveloped countries, which needs to work on garbage to create new incomes and to create a kind of a local economy. And on the other side, we have, let's say, the white world, you know, the white, not in terms of skin, but in terms of clean, minimal, elegant, our so-called world. What would you bring from the experience of Mumbai in our white and clean world to be considered as an interesting element to reconsider the way we live on our obsession of garbage? I mean, I think it's interesting to reverse the point of view.
Maybe I will start. For me, it was when Michael said interesting to know what recycling means for us in Europe when we think about recycling, it means burning all the garbages. So when we, for example, speak about Scandinavia, which is eco and green, and about recycling, it's only about burning our garbages. So we try to see and to teach different faces of recycling, which for us very interesting, that this is not the best way to just make, to burn all the garbages, which is not the only one answer for this problem, I think.
Also, it was quite amazing how people can very fast recognize the different type of plastics.
Material.
Yes, to use the sentences like the sound of it, or the if some plastic are floating on the water and some of them is drowned.
Under the water to kill fish.
Yes, to kill fish. So I think it was quite amazing.
Okay, cool. Is there any question from you in the darkness? Still somebody, yes, there's still a lot of people. So is there any question or any consideration, any comments, or what those guys
We pay 5 euros for the first question.
and the second one, a spritz. Okay, please. Is there a microphone?
And health.
Yes. Where's the microphone? I don't see anything.
So. I've got the mic.
Okay. Yep. Sorry.
My name is Guy. I'm a member of a new lectureship in Tilburg, the Netherlands, and the lectureship is bio-based building. And I have a question for Mr. Braungart. Do you have analysis of materials who are bio-based and who are chemical, not toxic?
I think the assumption behind this is the same what I tried to explain with the wool. It doesn't help you. We are all bio-based. Yeah, in that logic, that doesn't help you really. It's an assumption that bio-based would be better than synthetic in that logic. And I don't support this. I really, that we get older than 30 years is not because of Mother Earth. Yeah. It's because of us, because architects, chemists, engineers, biologists, and the bio-based strategy is pretty disastrous in a lot of cases where you see, for example, Europe now is using 21% of the agricultural land for bio-based fuels. Yeah. And this is a disaster. We lose, in Netherlands, we lose between 12 and 30 tons of topsoil per hectare in a year when we grow corn, for example, which is the biggest. So it's 5,000 times more soil than we make in a year, you know, so by this type of agriculture. I think the bio-based economy is a wrong idea because it feels somehow that we've apologized for being on this planet. We should speak up for synthetic systems, synthetic ideas as well, because we are bio-based in that, so we should not differentiate that in that logic. But where it makes sense are things like diapers, for example. Yeah. So Akzo Nobel has a patent which you should use for cellulose-based diapers, yeah, super absorbers. Yeah. And then we talked about land use and things like that. With one baby, a baby takes about 5,000 diapers, and you can reduce it by 10%, but does it help? Oh, by the way, in Amsterdam, 20% of the municipal waste stream are diapers. Yeah. And because we are getting older, diapers get bigger. So Hegel would have said life happens between two diaper phases. Yeah. So you're in the pre-diaper phase or in the after-diaper phase, whatever, yeah, depends on your age. But when you take collect these diapers and make a bio-based material for that, then this bio-based material can go into the biosphere. Yeah? And there it makes sense, because in Israel we did an experiment, and it's the same you can do in Egypt. You can grow with one baby, yeah, the diapers, when you collect them, and you use the superabsorbers and you sterilize it, it can grow with one baby 150 trees. So the baby can be carbon positive just by the diapers from the beginning for the whole lifetime. Yeah? So there, bio-based makes sense because it's designed for biological systems. And you can see at our installation, Toma, for example. Toma makes wooden houses. And sure, it makes sense to use clay and it makes sense to use straw, but you need to use it in a sense, yeah, where it's designed by nature for that purpose as well. Yeah? So wool definitely makes sense as an insulation material for purpose, but not really for a carpet. So it's a bio-based material in that logic. It has been used because for that purpose. But the question is the purpose designed for the biosphere? And then bio-based materials make sense in that logic. If we are importing at the same time, when we take 25% of our agricultural land for bio-based materials and fuels, we are importing the size of France, just of soy and other things to feed our farm animals. This is pretty perverse. Yeah. So it's ecologism. It doesn't help the ecology. It only keeps us busy. And I think the bio-based approach is wrong because it makes us basically quite small. It doesn't really celebrate our skills and our opportunities. You can see how far it is. There's not one organic label in the whole world, no Nature et Progrès, no Demeter, no Bioland, no EU label, which allows that my own nutrients can go back. So we feel only, it's only organic when my own phosphate cannot go back, and every day I need to pick up 2 grams of phosphate and release it to the environment, otherwise I cannot have bones and teeth. And phosphate is far more rare than oil. Is phosphate a bio-based material? So it's a fertilizer which is used and is contaminating all our agricultural land. We put 20,000, in 15 years, we put 20,000 tons of uranium on our agricultural land just in Central Europe. Yeah? It's far more than by any nuclear reactor. It's used in any nuclear reactors in that. So is it bio-based? And the first thing is to say, look, let's make an organic which includes us, where we belong to, where we are part of it, the whole thing. And I was in China, and when you live in the countryside in China till today, people expect you to stay after dinner till you use the toilet, because it's unfriendly to leave and to take nutrients with you, because you're invited for dinner, not for stealing nutrients. Yeah. So this allows a bio-based economy when you have a real bio-based thinking for that. If it's not, you make just another hype, which doesn't really help at all. Yeah. Sorry, that was a little long answer for that.
Michael, in a certain way, I would agree that we should not say, because this is some of these materials are artificial based, we should kick them out, but we should be aware how we create them, what are their byproducts, how they perform during their lifetime, are they designed to be recyclable, downcyclable in their lifetime. And I think that's something our society partially is missing, that things are designed out of a material often driven by cost, by first cost, not by lifetime costs.
Yeah, but the first thing is people project lifetime in a dead product. So people even make life cycles of Coca-Cola bottles. Yeah, how sick? Did you ever see a living Coca-Cola bottle? So why do you project life in a dead thing? Yeah. So why do we talk about a lifetime? Where it really makes sense is to talk about defined use periods, not a lifetime, because then you project life in dead things. And this doesn't help you. Where we can learn from bio-based things is not one chemical. I'm finding 2,500 chemicals in human milk, which accumulate. Yeah, as I said, nearly half of them are from buildings. Yeah. But there's not one natural material which accumulates, because nature is not stupid. So we can learn from nature as our teacher, but not as our mother. Yeah. Nature is our partner, we can learn. But so no lifetime in a dead product, whatever. Yeah, there's no lifetime of a window, whatever. Yeah, because it's not respecting life. Yeah, it's not respecting our life on this planet when you project life in dead things.
Yeah, well, maybe the title is wrong, but it's, if we talk about a lifetime of window, it's how long this window can exist in the way and do its service. And you may be right, then you go back to more simpler products, where a single piece of glass pane would perform for 300 years, why I'm pretty sure a double glazed, low E coated argon filled glass have a lifespan, let's call it lifespan, of 30 years, which is 10 times less. So the question is, and I think out of your definition, I think today all our targets and our regulations are so much focused on energy, and because in a certain way connected to carbon emissions, it was the energy the big. If I hear you, Michael, we have to think more about health. So we should, which should be our first target, because we want to survive, and we want that human society is surviving.
I have a question for Kowalski and Shazalina. What do you think the role is of wastewater and recycling in the year 2100, seen at the global warming, the sea rising, and what will be the role of Europe, Asia, for example, and Africa? And what if Europe encounters the same problems as the waste and there are now problems in Asia, for example, you see in Mumbai. Mm-hmm. And what if Europe encounters the same problems seen in 2100?
I think it can happen, but I don't really know what we can make with this garbage, yes? And it's, for me, it's very hard to say, how can see that we shouldn't make the material with from the garbage, like because sometimes they can be.
I think that as an architect, we must take more responsibility for what product we used to build our houses, and I think that this is challenging for sure, especially to collaborate with the companies for the main goal of the companies is to reduce the prices of the product to have more profits. So it's mean lower quality. But I think that this is one of the answer, especially that when we was in Asia and we saw all the aspect of recycling, and this is very difficult because as we already show you that we right now taking this, we starting to think about the Africa and the world is limited, so what's next? So I think that this is the right time to speak about the responsibility between us and to be honest, to use very, I think, concrete material for the architecture.
Okay, and just one little thing. If you look at the internet, there's O Instituto Ambiental. We have been doing now 150 facilities, and tomorrow at the matinee, you can talk to Doug Mohl and Katja Hansen. They will be there, they mostly did the work, where you can use the wastewater from favelas to do agriculture, and they work all. And the real nice thing is the crime rate in these favelas go down for more than 90%, because people want to be good if you support them to be good. Which they have a joint vision together, they don't kill each other anymore. So you can see this, you can have the building plan in all language, including Italian or Polish or Russian, and in that, so you can learn how to do wastewater treatment to use it for agriculture in that logic, and it's a plan that you can have it. And all these are in place because the farmer can make about $2,000 a month by running such a facility.
Any more questions?
Yeah, sure.
Sorry. No. Oh, yeah. That girl, yeah.
Hello, thank you very much for your panel and your inspirations. It's rather a comment, a statement, but I'm coming from Austria. Austria is so the seventh richest country in the world. And we are at the moment considering so I'm talking about social housing, and they are considering to replace the wooden frame windows and now to use plastic frame windows because it's cheaper. And social housing is in Austria quite a big deal it's a massive social housing. So, and you brought the example about foam insulation. If you build in Austria a family house, you just get funded if you use insulation. If you use a brick and thicker, so you have the same U-wert, you not get funded. Yeah. So it's, sometimes it's a little bit frustrating. So this topic is very important, and sometimes I feel it's good to have as well the best practice examples to get a little bit out of this sometimes very frustrating developments.
I wouldn't say that. Look, Austria has the highest percentage of organic food in the world. There's a lot of thinking, and sometimes sure, it's not cradle to cradle, it's more knödel to knödel. It's okay as well. Yeah, so they have a quality problem because they just jump on the train, but it's more ecologism in a lot of cases. But can you imagine there's still not one paint for wood which allows that wood can be burned later in a fireplace? Not one. Yeah. So it's an innovation opportunity. And there are now really nice wood preservatives which allow that you don't, the maintenance of a wooden window is not really higher than a plastic one from that logic. But you need to use these technologies as well. And sure, these are synthetic technologies. Yeah, you can use acetic acid to stabilize the whole cellulose in a way that it cannot rot anymore. It behaves a normal European wood behaves now like a tropical forest, if you want. But then you still need a paint which allows that the wood can be burned later. Europe has 10 million tons of treated wood which they have to burn as hazardous waste. So I agree on one side. Look, if I would have a choice, Austria is the best country in the world. So from that perspective, we can deal even with some right-wing populistic people. So they're really, really complaining at a very high level because this is just such a beautiful country.
But to give a more serious answer, I think Michael is a bit too cynical. Our regulations today are focusing on solutions instead of saying, okay, the target of the building should be a certain performance. If they would change it more performance directed, said, okay, this consumption should be used limited by whatever number, and then give the architects, the designer, the freedom. You can do it with a 50 centimeter brick wall, or you can do it with whatever, some layers of insulation if you're fine with as well the load this material is having. I think this would be more appropriate. And this is exactly the point where we as designers should create the pressure on the politics to go more, to give us the freedom to find the solution instead of telling us you need a certain level of insulation.
That's the reason our installation after the Biennale going to European Union, and we want to show politics that we have serious problem, and maybe we try to find an regulation together.
Okay. Somebody else? Sorry, I don't see. Ah, yeah, sorry. All two together.
Thank you very much for your inspiring talk. This is a question, well, for all the panel, but in particular Hugon and Anya as architects. I'm just thinking about Elon Musk recently unveiled solar panels. So they're small mass-produced tiles, and I'm wondering what you think their architectural effect will be. I mean, they're not on the market yet, but his vision is to unveil them across the world, and what do you think their architectural effect will be in relation to the environment, but also to aesthetics as well?
But you are saying about the roof panels or the facade panels?
The roof panels, but also his entire product range in a way.
Yeah. Sure, it makes sense as well to use the walls in that as well. Yeah.
So for me, it's like I say, I'm some young architect. It's a very hard question, but I know that's a lot of regulation. For example, in German, you can't now create the building with the glass facade because it's the limits are so tight, and I think like. Matthias said before that we should change the restriction from which a government give us, yes? And about the aesthetic, I think it's all of us have a different way of feel this thing, so I can say it, nothing.
For example, during our research, when we was trying to find these global companies, we also try to find the companies who really try to care about our world. And most of them produce the product which came from 100 from recycled material. But the problem is that we can use it, for example, in Europe, because our restriction is so high that they not have attest. So. This is about regulation, which I think it's important to speak about it.
Well, I think it's a very important thing that we solve this problem to integrate energy producing building parts into good design. So I haven't seen the parts you were talking about, so I find it hard to imagine, but what can I say? I think it's just what we have to do. It also makes no sense, as you said, we are biofuel on our land we could grow food on, and we producing electricity because we're putting PV on the green grass. I mean, that definitely makes no sense. So in the end, definitely buildings will have to integrate these energy producing parts. And it's definitely worth it to that really a lot of designers take it as a challenge and start working on it.
So I think it needs to go much further. We need to make all the surfaces interact positively. This is why I try to take this metaphor as a building like a tree. Yeah. Make a building which basically is beneficial, and sure, then the walls and the floors and all can have different positive impacts. And it's not about high efficiency, it's about using the space in a way that it supports life. But the energy side, this is what talking back to your brick stuff, sure, Wienerberger makes these bricks as well in Austria, yeah, for that. And I don't only say nice things about Austrians because they invite me for the matinee tomorrow. It's not. But if we really want to go into renewable energy, we need about six to eight times more overcapacity, because we cannot. We need to use. We have, for worst case, still enough electricity, and if we would use this extra power to make energy-rich materials like metals, like magnesium, for example, then we can oxidize these metals in the winter, and with 300 bricks you can heat a house without further insulation. The payback on insulating an old house is about 30 years, and it's not fair. People just paid for their houses, they are now 70 years old, and now we force them in countries like Germany into insulating their houses, where they just finished the payment for their house, and it's a payback time for insulating a house, an old house, is an average 30 years, so it's not fair. With the same amount of money, you would better celebrate abundance and make energy-rich compounds, that you can put them in small fireplaces and you can move them in your apartment, wherever you are, that you get this heat whenever you need it. And then the magnesium oxide can always be recycled into magnesium by extra electricity. So we better look for renewable energy in that way, that we use abundance of it instead of insulating our houses and seal them and make them sealed. Basically, the indoor air quality is a nightmare because all our products are not designed for indoor use right now.
Yeah. So we better, you're right, and certainly we should not look on the energy we're spending. If the energy comes from a renewable source, we can really spend it, which means we may not need all this insulation, we may not need all this airtight air buildings, but we have to be aware that this planet gets so much sun, much more than we can ever spend. So if we are able to collect it and store it right, this would be the technology to look on instead of building gas chambers, doing gas chambers by sealing our buildings.
But what I think is very interesting for all of you talk is that we are not finally discussing about a kind of eco-aesthetic, which is not the point, because for many years it seems that to be eco, to be green, was to be to do something completely different. Now we can build apparently normal buildings with a kind of using very advanced and very aware use of materials, creating what we are looking for, like an active building. So it's no more a time of formalization of the, let's say, ecological approach, but it's a kind of awareness which creates a process which allows building to act differently.
Mm-hmm. I think the sustainability period is over.
Yeah.
Look, if I ask you how's your relationship with your wife, what do you say? Sustainable? Yeah. Then I'm really sorry for you. True innovation cannot be sustainable. So let's just talk about three things: innovation, quality, and beauty. That's it. A product which becomes waste is just a quality problem. That's it. Yeah. So we needed this blame and shame and sustainability, ethic, feeling responsible thing, because we needed to learn about it. But now we can make buildings which are much better, much more beautiful. And sure, it's about beauty. That's why what your work is so key. And on the other side, it needs an understanding of material flows, because architecture matters. It's a key for that.
So I think it's perfect with this triad, innovation, quality, and beauty, looking for a healthy environment. we can close this fantastic talk. Thanks you all for being here, and thanks you all, and see you for the next.
By the way, I have a few invitations as well.
Yeah, please support the Boston meeting tomorrow. Thank you.